Close to 3 months after the tragic death of the ILG Secretary Jesse Robredo in a plane crash, the findings are out. Pilot error, false airworthiness checks, and flaws in aviation inspection caused the August 18 plane crash off the waters of Masbate.
Nauna po nating mabasa ang inisal na resulta ng investigasyon, magkahalong lungkot at pagkadismaya po ang ating naramdaman. Iisa po kasi ang itinuturo ng mga ebidensya. Kung tama lang ang ginawa ng ilang tao, kung sinunod lang ang mga patakaran ng industriya, kung nanatili lang na matapat sa kanilang obligasyon ang ilang sangkot, tsak pong naiwasan dapat ang nangyaring trahedya.
Aside from Robredo, the plane's pilot and aviator heirs Jesup Bahinting and his Nepalese co-pilot were killed. For aviator, Bahinting did his best. Aviator is likewise frowning on the crash probe findings, saying that for sure no pilot would ever risk his life and that of his passengers.
Any pilot would be ambitious of Captain Bahinting, will really try his best. But then, even how much you good you are on flying an airplane, kung ang aeroplano, mag-give up na din lang, di na masunod siya mong gusto.
Still, the president wants to make sense of the death of Robredo, one of the country's rare and exemplary public servants. Aquino has ordered all permits and licenses approved by the Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines to be audited, and the regulations for flying schools, air taxi, and approved maintenance organizations reviewed.
Lahat po ng permit at lisensyang inaprubahan ng CAAP, muli nating pinapa-audit, at kung may makita tayong dumaan sa shortcut at lumabag sa mga nakasaad sa Philippine Civil Air Regulations, agad po nating babawiin. Muli rin po nating sinusuri at pinapatibay ang mga alituntunin sa pagpapatakbo ng mga flying schools, air taxi, approved maintenance organizations at iba pang grupo na may kaugnayan sa industriyang panghipapawid sa bansa. Nais natin matiyak na kung hindi ka kwalipikado, hindi ka mabibigyan ng lisensya.
For now, Airworthiness Inspector Fernando Abalos, who approved the certificate of the ill-fated Piper Seneca plane, has been placed under a 90-day preventive suspension. As the CAAP investigates the matter further, cleans up its ranks of corrupt personnel, and ensures that the proper system of inspection is in place. As the Robredo plane crash exposes the faults in the aviation system, how will his death lead to genuine and long-lasting reforms in the air industry?
The findings of investigators on the Masbate plane crash opened our eyes to the ills plaguing the aviation industry. From possibly ill-equipped or unskilled pilots to collusion among airworthiness inspectors and private flying schools and companies to deceit and fraud in going around the rules and regulations. Airworthiness has become a big word following the death of Secretary Jesse Robredo and the probe that followed the crash of the plane that was supposed to bring him home to Naga. How can the government implement reforms in the aviation industry? What can be done to improve the system of inspections? And how can air industry regulators ensure the safety of flights? With us, Captain John Andrews, Deputy Director General of the Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines. We also have Maan Ontiveros. She is the Chief Executive Officer of Air Asia, and we also have Captain Benhur Gomez, President of Omni Aviation Corporation. Thank you very much for joining us. It's good to see you. I will begin with you, Captain Gomez. Of course, you were a commercial pilot in your earlier days?
I was with Philippine Airlines for 38 and a half years. The last 12 years, I was a 747 captain.
And that was how many years ago? When did you retire from Philippine Airlines?
21 years ago.
21 years ago, and now you are the president of Omni Aviation Corporation. And what is this?
Well, we are the largest flying school in the Philippines. We have over 300 students from 30 different countries. We have 25 airplanes. Mm-hmm. We're booming. We have zero budget in advertising, but we have all of these students because of our reputation of no cheating, no kidding.
Okay, and these are what? What kind of airplanes do you have in your flying school?
Yes, we have 25. Our flagship is the same as the one that crashed in Masbate. It's mm-hmm. a Piper Seneca twin engine. Then we have five Cessna 172 and 19 Cessna 152s in five different versions.
So this is where the pilot gets trained just for those types of airplanes.
Yes.
These people who go to your school do not get to fly a Learjet or other types of aircraft, bigger sized aircraft.
No, actually we train them to become generic commercial pilots, and they are airline ready. In other words, they have a commercial pilot license and an instrument rating. And from our flying school, they have like a professional driver's license. Mm-hmm. Then they can go to the airline and apply. And our graduates so far that have been accepted in the airlines have a 100% passing rating.
And these are the other jets, the big jets, the
yes.
747,
for example, yes, mostly the Airbus 320 of the different local carriers. That's the entry aircraft. Usually.
But they need to be trained again for those types.
Yes, for a type rating, they call, from a generic commercial pilot.
Generic.
And then they have to take up another course with the airline, and it's called type rating. For example, an Airbus 320 type rating. And there are some airlines that also operate turboprops. Mm-hmm. And then the airline will train them specifically.
Okay, your school does not have a simulator.
We have a
cockpit.
Simulator for our aircraft.
Oh.
For the type,
okay. We
are the only ones. We have a Piper Seneca. We have a simulator for the Piper Seneca. And a Cessna 172 simulator.
How long does one get to your school to be able to get that license?
Well, with us, to be airline ready, about 2 years.
2 years?
Yes.
And you need to be a college graduate, a high school graduate? What is the criteria or requirement for you to be able to be?
It's high school, but all the airlines require a college degree. So most of our students are either college degree or they're taking their college and at the same time taking up the pilot training. So by the time they graduate on college, they have a license and they're ready to apply for
you the have airline. 300
yes.
students
yes.
now as
yes.
we speak, and you say they are mostly foreigners?
No, I would say about 30%.
30%. And what countries do they come from?
From 30 different countries, from, well, China, mm-hmm. Japan, Indonesia, the Middle East.
So United language States. Language isn't a problem. You have teachers who can teach them, or they know how to speak English.
We have a basic, what we call, we teach them airspeak.
Airspeak.
Yes, because there are
it's like what we use in
yes.
our text
and
messaging.
And also,
now.
The ones that really have any problems, they go to
language
regular
schools.
School and take an English course, and they're fairly successful.
Okay, and you are regulated by
CAAP.
Captain Andrews here.
Yes.
Okay, so you're a flying school. You have students. You teach them how to fly. And then they get accepted in the bigger airlines, but they still have to undergo another training depending on the aircraft.
Yes.
Maan here is,
yes.
is my friend, I will let you know that. And she is now the head of Air Asia. And how is it like in your, you just opened about several months ago.
Yes, we started operating commercially in March this year. It's been quite an adventure for me.
Mm-hmm.
And prior to our operating, we had to do all of the certification process through CAAP. And
you had to deal
yes,
with...
Yes. I parked myself literally in CAAP for several months,
mm-hmm.
you know, during the whole certification process.
And how was the certification process like? Was it difficult? Did they have
quite
a lot
difficult.
Of...
A lot
of requirements that are...
Well, Tina, the list of requirements, as Captain Andrews will attest mm-hmm. to, it's quite long, okay? And we were the first airline to be certified under the new procedure. Yeah, because they instituted a lot of changes from after we got downgraded. Mm-hmm. And so it was a new certification process that we had to undergo, and the regulations compliance checklist, for instance, that we had to go through with the five-step certification process was very long. It's over 500 pages long. And we had to comply with all that. So the process was very, very tedious, very challenging.
You're a foreign airline?
No, we're a domestic airline.
It's foreign owned.
No. It's 60% Filipino and 40% Malaysian, mm-hmm. Which makes it a domestic airline. It's a Philippine airline.
It's a Philippine airline.
Yes.
And are you classified as a public utility?
Yes, we are.
Do you need a congressional franchise?
No, we can operate under CPCN, which is issued by the Civil Aeronautics Board. You do not need a congressional franchise.
Okay. And how many airplanes do you have?
We are the smallest airline. We only have two aircraft, but they're brand new Airbus A320s. Mm-hmm. So we're the newest player here in the Philippine aviation
industry. And how's business?
Tough. I mean, it's, you know, the airline industry, the business is not an easy business. It's mm-hmm. really challenging. It's not a walk in the park, but it's very exciting. And, you know, the prospects are very good.
Okay. Deputy Director General of the Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines, Captain John Andrews. So you are the regulator of Maan here, Air Asia, mm-hmm. and Captain Gomez here, Omni Aviation Industry. Is that all the scope of the different companies that you regulate? Just those two, the commercial airliner and the flying schools.
Including,
are there other sectors?
Yes, including the maintenance sector, the service sectors.
When you say maintenance and service sectors, what
this
does
is
that
the
mean?
AMO. Mm-hmm. Maintenance organizations.
And these are airline mechanics.
Yes, to include mechanics mm-hmm. who are certified in the aircraft.
So any airplane that comes here, be it privately owned, must register with you?
Yes, registration, of course, is necessary. Aside from that, they have to be airworthy. Mm-hmm. We are the ones who certifies the aircraft as being airworthy.
Okay, when you say airworthy, that means you have to physically check the aircraft and fly it and land it.
Yes.
And who does it?
Our inspectors does it.
How many inspectors do you have, sir?
Presently, we have 120, and we need about 200.
120 inspectors, and how many aircraft do you need to check in how many times in a year?
A aircraft inspections for the license is once a year. Now, an aircraft has inspections depending on the type of aircraft. It could be time inspections or use inspections, like 50 hours, 100 hours flight. It's got to undergo a certain type of inspection.
And how long do you conduct the inspection that the airplane cannot accept any passenger or any trips at all? How long does it stay in the hangar for you to be able to inspect it?
No, they must be inspected before the license expires, before the permit expires. Mm-hmm.
And what is the length of the life of the license?
1 year.
1 year. So every year they have to...
That is the annual inspection.
Annual inspection.
Aside from this, there are other inspections that have to be done.
Okay. And so how many times does an aircraft, like a Piper Seneca, gets inspected by the CAAP?
Depends
in
on
a
how,
year?
Depends on its usage.
Mm-hmm. Depends on its usage.
Yes.
So if it's been parked there for a long time and it has now a reservation to take off, do you go back to it after not having inspected it for almost 9 months?
There are time inspections. There are also different
What is that time usage? Inspection, sir?
Time inspection is 1 year. It has to be inspected within
okay.
1 year. Now, if it is being used, depending on the number of hours it's been used, because like engines have different inspection times, usage. Mm-hmm. Propellers, the same, they have different times. Wheels, brakes, and all these other accessories of the aircraft.
Okay, so in your tabulation of all the aircraft that you supervise and you regulate, how many have you inspected, and have you done all the diligent inspections of every aircraft
all
in this country?
All commercial aircraft has been diligently inspected. As
when you say commercial aircraft, sir?
These are airlines.
Airlines.
Uh-huh. Now, general aviation, to include the flying schools, air taxis, are different.
In what way, sir?
When we got into COP, that was about 4.5 months, we had about 60 flying schools registered. We only had 2 inspectors.
And how did the 60 flying schools get a license to be a flying school?
That is why we are overhauling the CAAP bottom up.
Mm-hmm. There was no requirement for capital investments. Did you have to have a number of airplanes to be able to become a flying school? What were
on capital investments? This is the purview of the CAB.
That's different. Civil Aviation
Board.
Okay. Yes.
They grant the certificate of public convenience.
Mm-hmm.
This is for air taxis and cargo operators. Now, for the flying schools, it's the ATOSID. That is for training. They have to get the certification for this.
Training for all the pilots?
No, for training flying schools.
Training flying schools. Okay.
Yes.
And the teachers of these flying schools is also under your supervision
teachers?
And regulation? Teachers.
Yes, they have to renew their licenses every year.
And how do they get a renewal of the license? What do they show to be able to?
Normally, a check pilot goes with them on flight or in simulator to check their proficiency.
An inspector from your office will either fly with them or go on a simulator to check their efficiency?
Proficiency.
Yes. Okay. And when you train, you give them a grade? Is this like a...
Yes. They either pass or they fail. Mm-hmm. That is if the check was actually done. As we have discovered, there have been some checks done only in paper.
And is this... What kind of numbers are we talking about? Of the 120 inspectors who inspected how many airplanes?
120 inspectors, most of them are for airlines. We only had 2 inspectors for the flying schools.
For the flying schools. Okay. So that's different from the aviation company that Captain Gomez has got.
Captain Gomez is the flying school.
It's the flying school as well?
Yes.
You don't rent it out for
air taxi,
charter or air taxi?
No.
With us, we are an approved training organization, which is a flying school, ATO, and we also have a permit to be an air taxi. So you use the
aircraft that you use for training your pilot students also for air taxi?
Yes. In a way, but we do not use, we do not carry passengers. If it's a commercial, like in Philippine Airlines, we use the airliner for training. But when it's a training flight, you do not carry passengers, or you do not use it commercially. We don't mix. In other words, if it's a training flight,
you don't use your student. If it's a training flight, the students
are not allowed in the airplane. And we do not, if it's a training flight, it's strictly flight instructor and a student.
Yes.
And if it's
an air taxi or a chartered flight, you like cannot let a student pilot
fly
with a
instructor.
With That's an right. instructor or yes. even a pilot. Mm.
Yes. So a commercial flight in our organization cannot have a student on board for training purposes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Stay.
We're the purest. I think.
So when this Piper Seneca that flew the chartered flight of Jesse Robredo, there was a pilot who we now find out was not trained to fly that kind of an aircraft. Is this the finding?
Now let's put things straight.
Yeah.
Captain Bainting was occupying the left seat. the Piper Seneca is authorized to fly one pilot.
Mm-hmm.
Does not require a co-pilot. Now, the student there, student pilot, was not registered as a pilot, but rather as a passenger who was occupying the right seat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, it's only our supposition that after the flight maybe had been completed, on the way back, it would have been used as a training flight. But there was also a problem here, because the student pilot was not rated in the Piper Seneca.
So how on earth was he able to take off from where he was? Who allowed the presence of these two persons if they had gone the checks of who is qualified to fly it and who is the real pilot?
No, Captain Bainting was qualified to fly the aircraft.
Was qualified?
He was qualified.
Okay. No. But allowing that other person to be
a passenger. He was a passenger occupying the right seat.
He never flew in your
No, he never flew. This was the report of the witness.
Mm-hmm. He never went on the pilot seat.
No, he never touched the controls. Let's put it that. Mm-hmm. These are dual control aircraft.
Okay, but what was his violation then? What was Captain Banting's violation in Aviators? If at all there was a passenger in the person of someone who was
that was
a student.
That was not the violation.
Ah.
See?
What was the violation insofar as letting this other person become a passenger and he was learning to be a pilot?
There was no violation as far as that was concerned.
Okay.
There was no violation in that regard.
So the Captain Bahanting was within the regulation that he could let somebody board.
Yes.
Be it this boy or another person,
yes,
for that matter.
In the right seat.
Okay.
As long as he was carried as a passenger in the flight plan.
And he was registered in the flight...
flight plan as a passenger.
As a passenger.
That's right.
And it was Jesse Robredo and the aide of Jesse Robredo.
Yes.
Okay. So what did you find in so far as the investigations went? Were the violations, if I may be very strong about it, what did they violate? Did they violate anything or was it just... A pilot error?
No. First of all, let's go back. In the certification of the aircraft for its airworthiness, a test flight is required.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we have found out through documentation that no actual test flight occurred.
Within what period should the test flight have been done?
When it was due for license renewal.
And what time of the year was that?
It was about several months before the accident. Because mm-hmm. it's a one-year span.
There was never any...
Actual test flight.
Actual test flight. And how many times had that plane been flying on a charter or air taxi before Secretary Robredo took that flight?
On the last few flights that aircraft had, there were reports already of the right engine malfunctioning.
And the reports are in a piece of paper?
Yes.
And who saw it? Kaap saw it?
Yes, Kaap saw it.
And what did they do?
What, big word?
What did Kaap do when they saw that
they were ready? They supposedly made corrective actions.
Supposedly?
Supposedly.
Mm-hmm. And?
And it was again allowed to fly.
Okay, so in your hierarchy of who does what, who checks it and who actually reports it, and what action the Kaap officials do, where was the lapse?
The lapse was in the ATO, Atosid Department.
Mm-hmm.
When we entered, when we joined Kaap, it's about 4.5 months ago.
Ah, you just joined Kaap recently?
4.5 months, been there.
4.5 months ago. Oh.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The first few weeks, before the first month, we had dismissed at least 40 people already. We had identified, dismissed. The Atosid was already in our radar as being very ineffective Mm-mm. and suspicious. So we, 10 days before the accident of Secretary Robredo, we dismissed the head of Atosid and replaced him with Captain Art Benaventura. Upon his assumption of duties there, he immediately saw deficiencies, forged documents, which brought to our attention.
Mm-hmm.
we were no longer going to renew the airworthiness or the certificate, both of the flying school and the air taxi at the time.
How many got affected?
All of them.
How many are these?
They have about 20, I believe, 20 airplanes.
Flying schools?
Flying, no, 20.
No, aviators. This
aviators.
Is just aviators.
Just aviators.
Okay, okay.
We haven't really still identified the others.
Yeah.
Too many of them.
Wow.
But as I said, we were just a bit too late, and we were overtaken by circumstances.
Okay, so now do you on a temporary basis actually check every aircraft that is being chartered or being used as an air taxi to make sure that all of them are airworthy?
We have
given the two. You still have two inspectors.
No, we are now. We are going to be getting at least 12 now for the general aviation.
12, and they're not yet on board.
They're coming on board. Okay. We have gotten some from the airlines to help us out, since we still have to train inspectors. Mm-hmm. We just cannot pull them out from.
Okay, is there a drop in the business of these air taxis and chartered flights?
No, I think it's been so great that it mushroomed over the years.
Mm-hmm. No, since the death of Secretary Robredo. Are business people more safe in just traveling commercially, or are they still using these Piper Seneca types and the Cessnas?
We still have not been able to go deeper into the private sector, on the general aviation sector.
Oh.
We are going to be having a meeting with all of them this coming Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
Explain to them what we're. It would be unfair to ground them all at the same time.
Okay.
We have check them each one by one, mm-hmm. audit them, and okay. if they pass the audit, then they're going to be
okay.
Released.
So if there's you can't ground them, because you don't have the people to do it. So what is the last minute check before we know that there are people who charter planes? We have a lot of guests coming in, hopping from one island to another. And how do you now do your job at the point of departure?
Now, there are general,
or even at arrival?
There are general aviation aircraft, which is bigger than the training aircraft. Mm-hmm. These are relatively safe because they have been monitored properly.
Mm, okay, so
they abide by standards. Mm-hmm. They send their pilots to regular training. That's including license renewals.
Mm-hmm.
They go to simulator training abroad.
Okay.
These are strictly monitored.
Okay, we'll get back. We'll pause for a break. We're talking about the future of the aviation industry. This is Talkback. We asked our friends on social media, what lessons can we learn from the Masbate plane crash? Brando Braganza says, dapat iklian ang kaap inspection procedure para maiwasan ang red tape at korupsyon. Athea de la Cruz says, sana nga magkatotoo na mas maging mabusisi ang procedure para malimitahan ang kunchabahan. Do you understand?
Yes.
Okay. Hanggang salita lang naman sila minsan. Gadget Meister says there has to be check and balance in the industry and not just adding extra procedures that could possibly make the red tape worse. Ray Noval says, time to start reforms in flying schools that may be in cahoots with air authorities, with more flights becoming more affordable, therefore leading to higher volume of passengers. There should be stricter guidelines in allowing aircraft in our airspace. Still with us, Captain John Andrews, Kaap Director General of the Civil Aviation Authority. We also have Maan Ontivero, she is the Chief Executive Officer of Air Asia, and Captain Benhur Gomez, President of the Omni Aviation Corporation, a flying school, but as well also renting out charter flights or air taxis. Okay, let me get back to you, sir. You boast very proudly that you are the biggest and with the most number of students. What did you institute in your flying school that has made you the leading flying school? What is so important about this business that you are in and the safety of your students and even your passengers?
One word.
What?
Integrity.
Integrity. And yes. How does one keep integrity in this kind?
We don't take shortcuts. We don't cheat. Mm-hmm. We maintain our aircraft properly. All of the spare parts we install have traceability. We buy them directly from the United States. No bogus parts, no recycled parts. And also at the same time, having a very strict culture among our flight instructors and mechanics that we don't take any shortcuts.
Okay, you have your own air mechanics.
Yes, we are also an AMO, an approved maintenance organization. We maintain our own aircraft.
And if there are simple procedures or policies that you have in Omni, what are they in so far as maintenance of your aircraft? How many times do you check? What do you do when a part breaks down? Just give us an example of what shortcuts you could actually do, but you don't do it. Where are the shortcuts done when you maintain an airplane?
Well, the most rampant of other of this is they say they make a paper correction, because if there's anything wrong with the aircraft, for example, aside from the scheduled checks like we do, we have a 25-hour check, 50-hour check, 75 hours, and then 100. And aside from that, we have the annual inspection. All right. When an airplane flies, and sometimes they'll find something wrong with the airplane, and the pilot writes it on the aircraft log. For example, brakes weak. And before that airplane will fly again, the mechanics are supposed to rectify it and fix it and put it on the logbook saying that we've replaced the brake pads or something like this, and check normal. But some other people would put on the logbook that they have checked the airplane and the engine, and they have not.
Okay, if the pilot reported in the log that brakes weak, does the mechanic have to fly or have to move that aircraft to be able to check how weak the brakes are so that he could apply the right kind of intervention?
No, there are procedures. Usually, if there's something like that, we bring it into the hangar, maintenance hangar, jack it up, and check, just like a regular car maintenance shop.
Yeah.
And they'll check the functioning of the brakes and things like this. You know? So we maintain the procedures very rigidly. And our philosophy is we do not try to save and economize on parts. We would rather err on the side of safety and spend more money than to try and scrimp and save on parts.
Is the maintenance of an aircraft, like the planes that you have, expensive? What is the ratio contribution to your overall profit? What constitutes the maintenance?
Well, it's part of...
That 80%, 50%?
I would say about 40%.
40%.
In fact, we just adjusted our rates. Mm-hmm. Because the cost of spare parts have gone up.
So you rent it by the hour?
Yes.
Flying time and ground time?
Mostly flying time. The ground time is for free unless they take the airplane overnight someplace.
Okay, so flying time is actually the from airport A to airport B. It has nothing to do, you can only fly in the Philippines.
Yes.
You can't take off to Kota Kinabalu?
No.
Or
we are a small, it's a flying school, and our aircraft do not have the range to go.
And you can land in small airports?
Yes.
And you can take off, you must take off before sunset if there's no equipment?
Yes, that's correct.
So what time do you normally leave a place?
Well, depending on sunrise to sunset. Like,
sunrise,
for example,
now
nowadays, towards December, it's a short thing. I'm guessing sunrise would be about 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And sunset is about 5:45 in the afternoon.
And at what altitude do you fly?
Well, our airplanes are not pressurized, so they can climb up to 10,000 feet.
10,000, and that's the maximum?
Yes, because we're not pressurized.
Okay, and you have no problem? You don't cause any problems to the towers as
Do you know,
there was a report that there was a proposal that all of these small aircraft land in another airport. Is that being seriously considered so that to decongest the traffic, the air traffic?
Well, they have been trying to decongest Manila and Clark. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the government has not provided an alternative site.
Sangli is no longer workable? Sangli.
Well, Sangli is being proposed.
Yeah.
But half of the runway is awash with salt water.
Because of their salt industry?
No. Because of the wind and all of that. And salt water is fatal to aircraft corrosion.
You can't land an airplane in Sangli. That's what you're saying.
No, they can land and all of that, but to base them there for a long time, there's no facility there right now. Okay. We have looked at it, and
it doesn't look like it will be the place where all of you guys can take off.
Charter operators do not want to go to Sangli.
Okay, what about Clark? The utilization of the Clark.
Well, Clark is beginning to get busy.
Yeah.
We are based in Clark, but we have our own private runway outside of the international airport. We're lucky. Mm-hmm. It used to be the former Clark Aero Club facility.
I see that from the... So, Ma'an, how's the traffic in Clark now? Are you the only ones using it?
I wish. You know, in the beginning, everybody was there. They were telling me, you must be nuts. Why are you flying out of Clark? It's so far from Manila. But, you know, now everybody wants to go to Clark. So, no, we don't have that airport to ourselves. But congestion there is not really bad. Mm-hmm. I mean, the air traffic congestion in Clark.
How many can that airport take on?
On landing and takeoff? I wouldn't know. What's
quite a lot. They still haven't reached their maximum.
Because that was for the Clark Air Base.
Yes, so, and you know we have parallel runways, you know, mm-hmm. and it's a lovely airport to be based out of.
And what about the terminal? Are they also decent enough to?
Well, the terminal is small, and they're doing renovations now to try and expand it, and they will be building a new terminal. But Tina, maybe also on what you had asked him. There are checks and balances. For instance, we don't have our own aircraft maintenance organization.
Oh, yeah.
We outsource it to SIAEP. But I have my own quality assurance manager, and our aviation engineers also have an oversight on all the checks that SIAEP does for us. So if there's anything wrong with the aircraft, there's dual reporting. SIAEP will be reporting it. We will be reporting it as well. And our own quality assurance managers are overseeing and making sure that all of these repairs are done properly. And we have our own spares. They're located in SIAEP. And as what Captain here said, you cannot scrimp on spares. You know, you don't want to buy second spares.
Do you actually have your own set of maintenance equipment to be able to do your maintenance check?
No, we don't.
You
don't. We don't have our own. That's why we outsource our maintenance to
SIAEP. So this maintenance group that you outsource your check, your maintenance check, is actually equipped to do the maintenance.
Yes, they are also licensed by CAAP. Yes.
Okay. So what in your experience, the maintenance organizations, AMO, is that?
Yes, AMO.
They are not CAAP. It's not CAAP. This is this is a private industry.
Yes.
That is contracted by the airline companies, both flying schools maybe and commercial airlines, to do the maintenance check for them. So they are not employed by you. They can be an outsourced group.
Yes.
Is that something good for your supervision and regulation?
In fact,
this outsourcing to many other groups to check every part of the aircraft.
In fact, the biggest airlines, the Philippines, like Philippine Airlines, Blue Pacific, outsource their maintenance.
Mm-hmm. And this is an industry practice in the world? Because it would be not efficient and effective if an airline company, airline company did their own maintenance?
They found it to be cost effective. That's why they have shifted to this.
Mm. I mean, I have only two aircraft.
Yeah.
For me to put together an aircraft maintenance organization and personnel, the equipment and everything would be so costly to cost out over two aircraft.
Okay, when that airplane that is outsourced to a maintenance organization gets into a problem and is traced that there was some kind of an incomplete check and maybe a paper what do you call that
paper maintenance
they close
who is held accountable?
Both
the airline and the AMO. So have you seen an improvement significantly in these AMOs?
No, with the outsourcing we have not had any problems. Mm-hmm. Because like Philippine Airlines, I believe it's Lufthansa Technique that's doing their maintenance.
Mm-mm. And these are Filipino airport airline mechanics as well.
Some of them are Filipino, but mm-hmm. the maintenance organization is
joint ventures,
mm-hmm. foreign and Filipino.
Okay, we'll get to the last stretch of Talkback in a moment and get their ideas of how they can actually, being in the industry itself. One is a government regulator, and two, one from the flying school and one from a commercial airliner. Final stretch of Talkback, you know, we'll stay with us. Welcome back. More comments from our viewers. Lisette of Cainta says, I echo President Aquino's sadness and dismay. Sayang ang buhay ni Secretary Jesse Robredo only because some people violated rules and regulations. From Leo Torres, a question for Deputy Director General Andrews. How much salary do airworthiness inspectors get and what are their qualifications? You'll answer that later. From Ning of Malabon to Air Asia, how is the local airline business doing? How do you make sure that your aircraft, although brand new, are well maintained? And from Casey of Makati, we laud Captain Benhur Gomez's adherence to strict guidelines and for showing integrity and for taking no shortcuts. These decisions and the values of your company could save lives. Okay, you are doing well. Is there any other thing that you want the government regulators of your industry do to further improve not just yourself, not just your company, but the others as well?
Yes, there must only be one way to implement regulations. But there are different interpretations and different applications to the same rule depending on who is being inspected and what they. So with us, we are 100% compliant because that's our culture. We don't cheat.
So the regulators don't have a problem with you, and then you don't have to pay off anyone because you're doing everything right.
But
okay.
Other people get away with murder.
Yeah.
Because they get concessions that we don't.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Well, they do. We'll have to do another story on that. Maan, what about you? Anything else you want to see your regulators improve on?
Well, I think the rules and regulations are there, and if they are followed, then we can be assured of safety. But beyond that, Tina, each airline also should set its own standards so that you don't just go by the minimum standards set by the Philippine Civil Aviation Regulations. For instance, with us, we have our own standards which are even higher than that. Our duty flight time limitation is more stringent than what is required of us. And then we have cascaded down to every single employee this culture of safety, mm-hmm. so that they have to report any kind of hazard mm-hmm. that they find in the workplace, so that it gets stopped before it becomes a problem.
A culture of safety. How much salary do airworthiness inspectors get and what are their qualifications? I think he's looking for a job.
Yes, normally they get about 35,000, which is about 30% of industry standard. We have been able to increase their pay 2 months ago to double. They're about 50% now of industry standard, plus some incentives were going to be given, like flying school, like flying pay, and hopefully we will get qualified inspectors joining us.
Okay, but they're all going abroad.
I think with these new incentives, we will be getting a lot of qualified.
That's good. So what do you want to see? You're just there 4.5 months ago, and what are the improvements, priority improvements?
It be a general overhaul of the whole system. We have replaced practically all department heads in the COP, but new ones. These are people with integrity. We are going to eliminate the old system, and we are going to give everybody a level playing field.
Are you subjecting these to some disciplinary disciplinary action? These people who have not performed that you replaced, how were you able to get them out of the job?
Because
just lateral transfers then?
Because most of them were either job orders or casuals.
Okay.
And some were, they were not organic personnel. We were immediately able to weed them out.
That's good. And maybe you can start sending out on your email address a job opening for people who are working overseas to come back here and match the salary.
We are still trying to get the salary up, because when Republic Act 94-97 was created, it was supposed to give CAAP fiscal autonomy.
But like the central bank employees.
Yes.
Then. Yeah.
But then GOCC law came into place, which again restricted us to a lot of government.
Interesting. So you want some kind of amendments to some rules and regulations, or are these just presidential executive orders?
These are presidential executive orders.
Okay. Thank you very much. It's nice to meet you. Finally, I've heard so much about you. Captain John Andrews, man, it's always good to see you. And Captain Benhur Gomez, maraming salamat. That's all the time we have. Talk to us again next week on Talkback.